Really, people, I said, praise the Lord. Wonderful to come and meet you in your house. And your house is beautiful. And it is time that you love one another. Don't you think it's time? I said, don't you think it's time? And I pray that the love of God will flow in every heart in Jesus' name. And tonight, something will happen to you. Something good. In your life. Your family. Because now it is time. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for today. Thank you for your children. Thank you for your people. Thank you for the singing. We thank you, Lord, because we know it is time to love you more. It is time to love one another more. And we pray that whatever hinders your love and whatever hinders us from building a bridge between our hearts and one another, we pray that you take every hindrance away in Jesus' name. Amen. Open every heart your word tonight. We thank you for all our brethren and all our brothers and sisters and friends who are here for the first time today. We pray, Lord, you do something wonderful in every life in Jesus' name. And we thank you for all our old members, our leaders, our workers, everybody. We pray, oh Lord, that today will be a turning around in every life in Jesus' name. Amen. Lord, it's our time to receive your blessing. And we pray that none of us will miss that blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you very much. We're coming to 1 John chapter 4. And tonight we're looking at verses 7 to 21. You'll find today that we're talking about love, teaching about love, because this passage is all about the love of God. The love of God towards us and the love of God in our heart flowing to other people. 1 John chapter 4. I'm reading from verse 7. It says, behold, it says, beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. Then we come to verse 21, and this commandment have we from him, that he who loveth God love his brother also. The first verse we have read talks about the love of God, and the love of God planted within us, flowing from us and reaching out to other people from us. And then the last verse also talks about love. And you're going to find, as you look at many of the verses here that we're studying today, everything is about love. But I need to tell you, this is the love of God. It's a special kind of love. It's a divine love. It's a heavenly love. It is a Trinitarian love. That is the love of the Father, the love of the Son, and the love of the Holy Spirit. It is a transmitted love. It is the love that transmits from heaven to earth. It is a love that transmits from Calvary to the heart of man. It's a love we get because we are born again. Actually, you remember the sweet verse of the Bible that says, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting love. Our salvation begins with love. The sustenance of our Christian life continues with love. And the culmination, the climax, and the glorification of our lives also terminates in love. And when we get to heaven, although many things will not be needed in heaven, like when we get to heaven, we'll not need faith anymore because we'll see everything very clearly. When we get to heaven, we're not going to be in need of hope anymore because what we're hoping for, now we have God. But when we get to heaven, love will continue. Why is that so? Look at verse 8. It says, he that loveth is he that loveth not, knoweth not God, for God is love. That means from all eternity to all eternity, God is love. In the past, love. And at the present, love. And then in the future, it's love. Look at verse 16. It says, and we have known and believes the love that God has to us. God is love. That's why they will say that as God is love, love will never pass away and love will never pass out. In every generation, the love of God is manifested unto this generation and any generations to come, because God is love. Therefore, love is eternal, from eternal past until eternal future. You'll find that love is still abiding. And it says, he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Tonight, as we look at these verses, we're talking about love enthroned in God's family. Love enthroned in God's family. The beloved John, that is the apostle, has taken care to make us understand that as we look at the family of God, we are the family of God who are born into the kingdom. He talks about being born again, and then he talks about little children. Look at chapter 2, verse 1. My little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin not. It says, now we have come into the kingdom. How do we come into the kingdom? How do we come into the family? We are born into the family. Born into the family. We're looking at chapter 5. In chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 4. It says, for whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. That means we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. As we believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, we became the children of God, born into the family. And in the family of God, there are young people and there are adults as well. We're coming to 1 John chapter 2. I read from verse 13. From verse 12 it says, I write unto you little children, because your sins are forgiven you. And then it says, for his name's sake. In verse 13, I write unto you fathers, because ye have known him that is from the beginning. I write unto you young men, because ye have overcome the wicked one. I write unto you little children, because ye have known the Father. So he talks about little children, that's a family. He talks about the fathers, that's a family. And he talks about young men, that's a family. And now what binds us all together? Our experiences are different. Our statures are different. Our understanding will be different. But there's something that is common among the children and the fathers and the young ones, and that is love. And that's why, as you come to this chapter 4, reading from verse 7, it's emphasizing the fact that there is something, there's a mark, there's a characteristic. And if you're a real child of God, if you're a member of the family of God, there'll be this love in your heart. Come back to chapter 4, verse 7. Beloved, and that's all the believers now is calling the beloved, those who are beloved of God, those who are born again, those who are children of God. And it says, we're beloved, it says, let us love one another. It says, if you're going to show that you're a member of the family, if you're going to show you have been born again, if you're going to show that your heavenly Father is in heaven, it says, there's one mark you are going to show. You may not be able to show the height of knowledge. You may not be able to show the wealth of riches. You may not be able to show experiences or whatever it is. But there's one mark you can show. There's one evidence you can show. And there's one characteristic you can demonstrate. It says, let us love one another. Why? For love is of God. For love is of God. And that is the blood that runs in the vein of every child of God in the family. And it says, everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. Look at verse 8. He that loveth not, knoweth not God. That is the people that will join the assembly. They join the fellowship. They just join. They are not born again. And because they are not born again, they do not have the characteristics of members of the family. And they do not have this life blood in the family. It says that those people, they may claim to know God, but he that loveth not knoweth not God. Why? For God is love. And then in verse 9 it says, and this was manifested, the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. It says our spiritual life, our eternal life, our life with the Father, relationship with the Father began in the love of God. It says here in his love in verse 10, not that we loved God, that is, the love did not originate from us. We didn't begin this experience of love by ourselves. It is, he said, not that we love God, but that he loved us and he sent his son to be the propitiation for our sins. That word propitiation there means the covering for our sin, the atonement for our sin, the redemption from our sin. That Jesus sent his only begotten son to get that done for us. As I've told you, we're talking about love enthroned in God's family. As we look at this chapter, that is the verses we're looking at, we're dividing into three parts. Number one, the eternal characteristics of God the Father. The eternal characteristics of God the Father. You're going to find it throughout the passage. It's talking about God, and it says, this is how you know God, and this is the mark by which you recognize the operations of God. And that characteristic is not something temporal, it's not something of one dispensation, it is eternal, the eternal characteristics of God the Father. Now, number two, the explicit commandment in God's family. The explicit commandment in God's family. God has a large family. And it says, as large as that family is, here is the commandment of God to every member of the family. And the commandment is explicit. It is very plain. It is very clear. And it is something you can't shift here and there. And there is no alternative to this. It's the explicit commandment in God's family. And then number three, the expressed confidence of God's followers. Those who are following God, here is the expression they have, the confession they have, and here is how you will recognize them, and here is the confidence they'll have in the Lord. Number one, the eternal characteristics of God the Father. Number two, the explicit commandments in God's family. And number three, the expressed confidence of God's followers. We're coming to number one. Number one is the eternal characteristics of God the Father. Let's come to chapter 4, verse 7. That's the passage we're looking at today. 1 John chapter 4, verse 7. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. Now, you're going to find, as you read through the verses we're looking at, you'll find some repetition. That is, it talks about our responsibility, let us love one another. Then it talks about the role of God himself. And it talks about the characteristics of the mark, the evidence that you'll find in God himself. And we have separated them so that everything will be clear to you and to all those who are studying with us. We're looking at now the section of God, the part of God that is the eternal characteristics of God the Father. And so you find in that verse 7, for love is of God. Love is of God. And everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. Look at verse 8. He that loveth not knoweth not God. There might be people that will say, well, you know, that's not my specialty. That's not my expertise. That's not my learning. That's not my leaning. Love is not one of the things I specialize in. He says, no, not at all. If you don't love, if you say, well, I'm going to concentrate on other things, I don't want to concentrate on love, it says you'll not be of God, because the characteristic of God is love. That's why it says at the end of that verse 8, for God is, tell me out loud, love. God is love. Look at verse 9. In this was manifested the love of God. It says, how do I recognize that love of God? If we say God is love, I've not seen him, just like I cannot see the wind, but you can see the effect of the wind. There are many things you cannot see, but you can see the effect of what we're talking about. How do we see the effect of the love of God? That's what it tells us in verse 9. In this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. It says, that's how you recognize the love of God. That's how you taste the love of God. And that's how you experience the love of God. We're looking at John chapter 3. John chapter 3. to support what we just read in that verse. We're looking at chapter 3 and verse 16. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. The love of God does not want us to suffer, either to suffer in this world or to suffer in the great beyond. And there's no way a sinner will not suffer. And so that will not suffer, God manifested his love. He sent his only begotten son that he will die for us. He'll take our sins away, and he'll take the penalty and the punishment of sins away from us. And he makes it so very simple. Turn away from your sin and then believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and eternal life will be yours. If you have not done it yet, you'll do it today. Putting your faith in Christ, placing your faith in Christ, so that you will not perish and so that you will not suffer here in the world or in the world to come. It tells us in Romans chapter 5, is it telling us the evidence of this love that we seek and that we read about in God, that God is love. How do we know God is love? He sent his only begotten son so that he will die for our sin, die for iniquity, and so that we will not perish. Look at Romans chapter 5, reading here from verse 6. It says, for when we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. That is, the ungodly does not have strength. The sinner does not have strength. Sinners do not have any strength against Satan. Sinners do not have any strength against sin. Sinners do not have any strength against evil spirit or the circumstances that sin may create. And when we didn't have any strength, if the Lord waited until we're very strong, because before we could be saved, we'll never be saved. But because we didn't have strength, and we couldn't save ourselves, that's why he sent the Lord Jesus Christ. For when we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. Look at verse 8. But God commendeth his love toward us. God commendeth his love toward, say, me. God commendeth his love towards who? Me. Towards you. In that while you are yet a sinner, Christ died for you. Christ died for you. There's some people that are thinking, I want to become a better person before I believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. No. Why do you want to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ? Because you are bad. He came for bad people. He came for sinful people. He came for weak people. He came for people that could not help themselves, so that he will help you. And it is while you were yet a sinner, that's when the grace of God flows into your life. That's how we know God. Because you know, human beings, they love you if you do good unto them. They're not going to start doing good to you first until you make the move. But God made the move first while you were still bad, still sinful, still filthy. The Lord showed his love. And it says, but God commendeth his love towards us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. Christ died for us. Much more than being now justified by his blood. Because he shed his blood before you could be saved. And thank God that blood will wash any sinner, will cleanse any sinner. No matter how dirty you might have been, the blood of Jesus washes and it cleanses us, washes us whiter than snow. It says, we shall be saved from wrath through him. We shall be saved from wrath through him. That's the love of God. That love will not allow you to perish. That's the characteristic of God, because he sent his only begotten son so that you will be saved. And that's why you need to go and tell your friends and tell your neighbors that God has manifested his love. God has shown his love. God has declared his love. And God has revealed his love on Mount Calvary. He died for us. He took our sins away. He shed his blood so that you will not perish. And thank God you will not perish. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And we're looking at verse 19. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19. It says, to which that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself. The world, sinful world. The world that is devilish, the world that is defiled and the world that is under judgment. It says the judgment will not come upon the people that believe, because it says God sent Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, reconciling the world to himself and not imputing their trespasses unto them. And then he has committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you, we plead with you, in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. He's telling us that there's nothing to be done that has not been done. Your salvation is available, and your sustenance is available. The grace of God is available. All you need to do is to come and say, Lord, I come. I come because you called me. I come because Jesus Christ died for me. I come because the blood of Jesus Christ will wash me whiter than snow. And that's why it says, now we are pleading with you, and we're saying, be ye reconciled unto God. He's done something. Look at verse 21. What has he done? In his love, he has made a great exchange, an eternal exchange. He has taken your sin from you, and then he has given you salvation. He has taken your unrighteousness and your ungodliness, and he has given you his own righteousness. Verse 21, for he has made him to be sin for us who knew no sin. He made Jesus Christ to be the sin offering, to be the one that will make atonement for your sin, and to be the one that will carry all your sins away. He made him to be the sin offering for you who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Because of his death for you, now you become the righteousness of God, because he died for you. It's the same thing. Ephesians chapter 2 is still emphasizing to everyone that if you missed it in Romans, if you missed it in other places, now Ephesians is telling you the same thing, that even though we are sinners, because the love of God has been shed abroad in the heart of everyone, now you can come to the Lord, and the Lord will save you by his love in Jesus' name. We're looking at Ephesians chapter 2 verse 4. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us. His great love wherewith he loved us. What does that mean? His great love. What it means is that your sin will never be too great for the love of God to reach you. You've sinned greatly, the love of God is greater. You've gone so deep into sin, the love of God is deeper. And you've gone so far into sin, the love of God is farther. Because it says, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sin, he has quickened us. That he has made us alive. He has brought us to life again. He has quickened us together with Christ. By grace are ye saved. I pray that you'll taste of that grace tonight in Jesus' name. And let's come back to this in 1 John chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4, and I'm reading here from verse 7 and reading from verse 8. We're reading from verse 7 and verse 8. It says, beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. For love is of God. You can tell anything that is different from love is not of God. Hatred is not of God. Is that right? Bitterness is not of God. Is that right? Wickedness, oppression, that's not of God, because it says, for love is of God. And then it tells us in number 7, it says, and everyone, no exception, everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. Look at verse 8. It says in verse 8, and he that loveth not, knoweth not God, for, tell me the rest. Tell me out loud. God is love. Now we need to explain this a bit. Well, when we say God is love, that means his nature is love. That means his characteristic is love. That means the evidence of what comes out of him is love. And there are many things that happen in this world, and many people, they do not understand that there are some things that Satan does. There are some things that human beings do. do. There are some things that wicked people do because we're free moral agents, and God doesn't control everything that people do. If God controls everything that people do, he will not judge anybody. If God controls a thief to go and steal, he cannot judge a thief because he told him to go and steal. If God controls or commands or compels somebody to murder another person, he cannot judge that murderer because he compelled him, he controlled him, he made him to do it. And the person could say, God, you made me do that. If you made me do that, how could you judge me? That tells us something. It says, for God is love. Sometimes, you know, some things will happen. Let's say, for example, somebody builds a house, and then, you know, the people that build, they didn't build it very well, and then there was a storm, and the house collapsed, and 2-3 people were killed, and some people will say, how could God do this? Why did God do this? Look at what God has done. My friend, God has not done that, because God is love. You know, that sometimes somebody is drunk, and is driving, and while he's driving, he forgets, he loses control, and then he has an accident, and an innocent person dies by the side of the road. And some people go, how could God have done this? But they said God is love. My friend, there's a Satan in the world. My friend, there are sinners in the world. There are drunkards in the world. We cannot accuse God of doing something that a drunkard has done, that a wicked man has done. Sometimes there is a river that, you know, overflows, and they've been warning the people. The warning has been coming from the radio, from television, from internet, everywhere, that a tsunami or whatever is coming. Therefore, check out and don't live in that place. And the government has offered to evacuate people out of that place because they knew that that thing was coming. And some people, they just stay there. They say, this is my land and this is my house. Any tsunami coming will meet me here. And eventually that thing comes, and then some people lose their lives. Every time they go back, they say, God has done. Look at what God has done. God has not done that because God is love. Everybody say, God is love. Our carelessness may injure our lives. Our wickedness may injure our lives. And the things, bad things we do may injure other people. Don't attribute that to God, because it says God is love. Come to chapter 4 verse 16. In chapter 4 verse 16, it says, and we have known and believed the love that God has to us. God is love. In your life, you'll find that experience of love. In your family, you'll find that experience of love. You'll find that God is love, and everything he does in love, and the love of the Lord will be magnified in your life, in your family, in Jesus' name. He that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. He that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Sometimes you'll find some religious people, they do some weird things. Religious people, they do some wicked things, and you know, sometimes they help the lives of other people. People are going to a particular place, they call a church, and then that person there who appears to be their leader there, he does some weird things, some wicked things, some cruel things, some terrible things, and then you call him to question. You see, you've injured the life of this, you've injured the life of that, and he says, don't challenge me. God told me to do that. God made me do that. You see, I'm a man of God, and whatever I do, that's what they say, whatever I do, it is God that has done that. Look at this. Look at that verse 16 again. It says, the latter part, he that dwelleth in love dwelleth, tell me, in God, because God is love. He that dwelleth in hatred dwelleth in Satan, because Satan is hatred. He that dwelleth in wickedness dwelleth in evil spirits, because evil spirits are wicked. When we do things that are contrary to love, we cannot attribute that to God. When we do things that are contrary to peace and to joy and to mercy, we cannot attribute that to God, because it says God is love. I need to tell you another thing, because there are many people, when they think about God, when we say God is love, they forget some other attributes of God. They forget that God is light. Look at 1 John chapter 1 verse 5. First John chapter 1 verse 5, it says, this then is the message we have heard of him and declare unto you that what? That God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. Remember, God is love and God is light. You must also remember that God is holy. God is love, yes. God is holy too. Isaiah chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 3. Isaiah chapter 6, and we're looking at verse 3. In Isaiah chapter 6 verse 3, it's talking about the characteristic of God. It's talking about the nature of God. It's talking about these attributes of God. And one cried unto another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. So then you put all that together. God is love. Don't stop there. God is light. Don't stop there. God is holy. Why do we say that? Because many people do not understand. They feel that God is love. Full stop. But God is light. He'll not do anything contrary to light. And God is holy. He'll not do anything contrary to holiness. Not only that, God is just. Isaiah chapter 45, and I'm reading from verse 21. Isaiah chapter 45, we're reading from verse 21. In Isaiah chapter 25, verse 21, here is what the word of God is telling. It's to tell ye, and bring them near. Yea, let them take counsel together. Who has declared this from ancient times? And then he goes on to say, who has told it from that time? Have not I the Lord, and there is no God else beside me? A just God. Is a just God. That means is love, yes. Is light, yes. Is holy, that's true. And then it's also a just God. You know, there are people that, they only take that attribute of God. They say, God is love, God is love. If God is love, God, give me this, give me this, give me this. You must also remember that God is just. And if that thing is unjust, if that one thing will bring injury to another person, if that thing will look like injustice to another person, he cannot manifest love contrary to the justice of God. Everything must balance together. Everything must go together. He is love, yes, and he is light, and he is holy, and he is just, and God is true. God is true. We're looking at John chapter 3. And I'm reading here from verse 33. John chapter 3. And we're reading from verse 33. God is true. In verse 33, we're looking at this. John 3 verse 3. Therefore said the disciples one to another. That's chapter 4. Chapter 3, verse 33. Chapter 3, verse 33. He that has received his testimony has said to his seal that God is true. And so, let's say, for example, you've told a lie. And as you have told in life, so God, I don't want to come to shame here. I don't want to come to a disrepute here. This sin will be the disgrace upon my life. God, I know you love me. You will cover me up. I know you love me. You are going to get me out of this. And this lie I have told, oh God, help me and support me and convince everybody that this is the truth. God cannot do that. You're making the love of God to contradict his truthfulness. Because you see, all the attributes of God, they work together, and they work in cooperation together, and they coordinate together, and one does not displace the other, and one does not contradict the other, and one does not cancel the other. God is love, but God is true. God is love and God is just. God is love and God is light. God is love and God is righteous. We're looking at Daniel chapter 9. In Daniel chapter 9, I'm reading here from verse 14. Daniel chapter 9, and we're reading from verse 14. God is righteous. It says, therefore, as the Lord watched upon the evil and brought it upon us, for the Lord our God is righteous in all his works. Is righteous in all his works. You know, there are people that just think about God is love and God is love, and they expect the love of God to contradict the fact that God is righteous and that God is just and God is incorruptible. God is incorruptible. That you'll find in Romans chapter 1, verse 23. And God is of purer eyes than to behold iniquity. You cannot say God is love and then you're doing evil, doing iniquity. You say, God, don't look at this, don't frown at this, and don't judge me for this. I know you are love, and whatever I do, everything will just pass like that. No, not at all. Because God is pure and is of purer eyes than to behold iniquity. And God is unchangeable. God is faithful. God is perfect. And God is eternal. The reason why we have to mention that is so that you understand that the love of God is not a sentimental kind of love. God is love and God is holy. He manifests holy love. God is love and God is just. He manifests just love. And God is holy and God is righteous. He manifests righteous love. And God is unchangeable, immutable. He manifests eternal, unchangeable love. And so we understand God is love, the characteristics of God. And now, what does God do in his love? We're looking at Proverbs chapter 3. Proverbs chapter 3. Let's see the actions of God as he manifests his love. When he shows his love, you need to understand that he balances up all his attributes. Proverbs chapter 3 and verse 12. It says, for whom the Lord loveth, tell me what follows. Tell me out loud. He corrected. Whom the Lord loveth, he corrected, even as a father, the son in whom he delighted. That means it's not sentimental love. It is love that is based on truth. It is love that wants to develop you. It is love that wants to chastise you if he needs to. It is love that ought to correct you if you are going wrong. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, the love of God. What that love of God does. Eventually, he wants to take you to heaven. And he will do everything that will get you to heaven. When he corrects you, it's so as to take you to heaven. When he chastises you, that's so as to take you to heaven. And when he rebukes you, that's so as to take you to heaven because of his love. Because of his love. In Hebrews chapter 12, we're reading here from verse 6. Hebrews chapter 12, and we're reading from verse 6. In verse 6, this is what he tells us. For whom the Lord loveth, he chastiseth, and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. That's the love of God. That's the love of God. He does that when we're going wrong. Look at verse 10. It says, for they verily, talking about our earthly fathers, they verily for a few days chastened us after their own profit or pleasure. But he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness. He knows that without holiness no man shall see the Lord. And when we're going astray, he'll correct us and bring us on the path of holiness so that we'll eventually get to heaven. Revelation chapter 3 verse 19. Revelation chapter 3 verse 19. As many as I love, I rebuke. As many as I love, I rebuke. So it is telling you about the love of Christ and the love of God. It's not the love that is sentimental. It's not the love that will see you going astray and then he leaves you to go astray and then to perish. Why? Because he's love and he's just. Why? Because God is love and God is light. Because God is love and God is righteous. Because God is love and God is good. He says, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasing and chasing. And then he goes on to say, be zealous therefore and repent. We're coming back to 1 John chapter 4 as we look at the second part of our study tonight. The explicit commandment in God's family. Explicit commandment in God's family. If we're members of the family of God, here is the commandment of God for each of us. And the grace of God will see us through. And the grace of God will make us obedient to his word in Jesus' name. We're looking at 1 John chapter 4 verse 11. It says, beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. It says, if God so loved us, is it not you don't have any excuse? We don't have any excuse. If God has loved us, he has forgiven us. If God has loved us, he has given us grace. If God has loved us and he has saved us. If God has loved us, he has written our name in the book of life. If God has loved us and he has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. If God has loved us and has gone to prepare a place for us in heaven. He said, because of that love, we must reciprocate to members of the family of God. We ought also to love one another. Look at verse 12. It says, no man has seen God at any time. Why is he saying that? He said, somebody will sit there, if I could see God, I will show that love to him. He's done so much for me. He forgave my sin. He saved my soul. He's taking me to heaven. I love God so much. All I want to do now, I want to see that God and show my love to him. Look at this. It says, no man has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwells in us and his love is perfected in us. It says, how can you show your love back to God? By showing your love to members of the family, the least of the children of God. Let him taste of your love. Let her taste of your love. It says, that's how we can reciprocate. That's how we can show our gratitude for the love that God has given us. Look at verse 13. It says, hereby know we that we dwell in him and he in us, because he has given us of his spirit. See what he has given us. He has given us Jesus Christ. He has given us grace. He has given us mercy. He has given us salvation. He has given us the Holy Spirit. And he has given us even the book of life. He has given us this Bible that leads us to the way of life. It says, if he has given us all this, with all this that God has given us, what should we do? We should love one another. In verse 14, and we have seen and do testify that the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. And not just to be the Savior of the world, and you in particular in the world, he has saved you. Give me a good amen. Amen. And because he has done that, he said, what have you done to show that you appreciate the love of God? And then it says in verse 15, whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, dwelleth in him and he in God. And let's come back to that verse 11, which begins this section. It says, beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. We ought also to love one another. And that verse is not strange to us. We all know that verse. We ought to love one another. And many of us also, we sing it in songs. We love each other. We love one another. How do you show that you really love? How do you show that you love your brother, you love your sister? The way you show that, assist one another. Assist one another. If somebody is carrying a load, and then you are passing by, and you see he's struggling with that load, he cannot carry it alone, and then you just pass by. Where is the love? If you want to show that you love, assist one another. You want to show that you love, bear one another's burdens. Bear one another's burdens. Or we can say this way, the way the choir sang it, build a bridge between you and them. Here you are in the fold. Here you are in the church of the living God. And that person is going his way and that person is going his way. And you've never spoken to each other. Maybe there was a quarrel, there was a misunderstanding between you. How do you show the love of God? Build a bridge. Build a bridge. It may be that you'll be the one to break the ice and to break the silence. And then say, how are you there? And say something that will be of benefit to the other fellow. You assist one another, you build a bridge, you bear one another's body, you care one for the other. Somebody is sick, God will show that we have love. You go and show the care to them. You visit them, you show love to them, and you show that you really have the love of God. You assisting the people you love, you bear the bodies of the people you love, you build bridges of the people you love, and you care for the people that you love. You defend each other in a very good way. Defend each other in a very good way. You see that helpless person, helpless sister, and you see that defenseless sister, somebody is trying to oppress her, and you have the opportunity to defend that sister. You might have to defend that sister while paying house rent. You might have to defend that sister by, you know, speaking to that person, trying to oppress her. But one way or the other, do something that will show that that sister will say, thank God, I belong to a family, to the family of God. Because I have assistance, because I have people to bear my body, because I have people that care, because I have people that defend, and because I have people that encourage. If you want to show that you really love, you see, there are sometimes people are going through trials, they're going through trouble, and they're going through some challenges in life, and they're so down, and they're so weak, and they're so sorrowful, and the body is so much for them to carry. To show that we love, you will encourage them. My brother, answer is on the way. My sister, God is still on the throne. God will do this and God will do that. If we show that we have love, you'll fellowship one with another. That's love. You fellowship one with the other. But I love you, you love me. No fellowship, no greetings, no how are you, nothing at all. I feel lonely, you feel lonely. There are people that feel lonely in a crowd. They feel lonely in an assembly like this because nobody has any fellowship with them. But it says, my beloved brethren, if God so loved us, let us also love one another by fellowshipping one with the other. So that I isolation is not there. Insulation is not there. What does that mean? You don't insulate yourself and stay somewhere. We cannot reach you. We cannot talk to you. We cannot touch you. You cannot touch us. We cannot help you. You cannot help us. That's not love. Love means that isolation is gone. Insulation is gone. And we're able to love each other. It also means that you give yourself to other people. Give yourself to other people. That's love. You give of your talent, you give of your time, you give of your money, you give of your ability, you give yourself to others, and you help other people. Help other people. If you're going to show that you have love, you must help. You know, when a church like this, there are rich people, there are poor people, let the money flow. And there are strong people, there are weak people, let the strength flow. And there are experienced people, there are inexperienced people, let the experience flow. It is by the love we show to one another that we can really tell there is love in the church. You influence each other for the better. Influence each other for the better. What influence do you have on your brother there? What influence you have or your sister, that's what is love. That's what love is. It is the aggregate of all this. It is the combination of all this, assisting each other, bearing one another's burden, building the bridge between us, one another, and caring for one another, defending other people, and encouraging other people, fellowshipping, giving of yourself to other people, helping other people, influencing them. That's how we see that we love each other. And then when not quick to judge. Judge not. You see, there are many people, all they know is, you know, this is wrong and that is wrong and that is not right and that is not good. That's judging. There's no fellowship. You drive us away from you when you judge us. You judge us too quickly. and you judge us too severely, and you judge us without any mercy. If we're going to show that we love each other, we're going to be quiet on this judgment and judgment and criticism all the time. You judge them. Do you remember when God asked Cain and said, "What is Abel thy brother?" He said, "I don't know what he is. No love there. Am I my brother's what? Am I my brother's keeper?" He was saying that I have nothing to do with him. I don't know where he's gone. I don't know what has happened to him. And actually, he was of the wicked one, and he killed his brother. If we're going to show that we love each other, you keep one another. You keep one another. You'll keep your brother. You'll keep your sister. Don't keep them in a prison. Don't keep them in confinement. Don't keep them in sorrow. You keep them in life. You keep them in something good, that they'll say, "I praise the Lord for the love in this place," because we keep each other. You liberate them. You liberate them. You know, and they've tied down somebody there, or they've tied, you know, a particular brother, a particular sister, tied with sorrow and tied with grief and all that. You go there to liberate them, set them free, loose them, and let them go. Let them enjoy life. Life has no duplicate. Not only that, life is very short and very brief. How many years do we have in the world here? Make the life of somebody happy. Make the life of somebody worth living. That's the love. So that you are liberating other people. You liberate the people that have sorrow. Liberate the people that have sickness. Liberate the people that have bondage. Liberate the people that are suffering. It is that liberation. It is that setting free. It is that loosing them that shows that we have love one to another. That's why it says in that verse 11, it says, "Beloved, if God so loved us," it says, "see that we ought to love one another." It also means that we're merciful unto each other. You know, if there is no mercy, we act like, you know, here we are like in the barracks, and then we're militant and we're wicked and we're oppressive. It says that's not love. You will show mercy, manifest mercy to other people. You nurture others. You nurture them in the things of God and nurture them in the ways of God. It is that nurturing and building up and encouraging them so that they will be the people they ought to be. Anytime I see that brother, I have nurturing. I'm nourished, I'm encouraged, I'm empowered, I'm strengthened from within. That's how we show the love. It's not a theoretical thing. It is not, you know, a sentimental thing that we don't know what we're doing when it says we love one another. It also means that we don't oppress other people. You want to oppress somebody you love? Maybe you have somebody working with you at home. Maybe she's the cleaner, maybe she's the cook, and maybe she's the maid, and we treat her like a rag. That's not love. We will not oppress if there is love. And then you pray one for another. "Brother, are you praying for me?" "Oh, I have too much a problem myself. I'm looking for prayer. I'm seeking prayer myself." No, you'll not do that. We pray one for another if there is love. And then you're quieting the fears of other people. Quieting the fears of other people. Do you watch people as they come to the fellowship? You see that person, you can see fear written on the face. You can see fear. It's like when she's in the fellowship, there's fear. When she's going back home, there's fear. Let somebody approach that brother, approach that sister. Looks like there's something in your life that makes you fearful every time, and you're quieting their fears. We rejoice with those who rejoice. That's love. That's what the Bible tells us, that if we have love one to another, we rejoice with those who rejoice, and we weep with those who weep. You support the weak. That's how we show love. You support each other. As you see other people, they have loads heavier than they can carry. They have lives that are harder than they can bear. And you support them. And we teach one another. teach one another. There's something you know the other fellow does not know, and it will do him good. Teach one another, uphold one another, uphold one another. Somebody is falling and somebody is getting a kind of depressed or somehow, you uphold them. Positive things that we do to help other people and to show the love of God unto them. We visit the sick, we visit the weak, we visit the backsliding, we visit the people that do not have people who will take care of them. We watch over our brethren and we warn the unruly, we warn the people that are going astray. That's how we show the love to each other, and then we exhort them. As you see the days approaching, we exhort them and we yield to each other. We yield to each other. You know, there are many people that they're too self-willed. They're too self-willed. Two people are living in the same house, and this one is going this way, this one is coming that way, and they're going to be on collision. And they know that, you know, if I say this, I'm going to collide with him. If she says that, she's going to collide with me. And nobody is willing to yield. That's not love. That's not love. You will yield your right. Just like, you know, a car is coming this way, a car is coming that way, and you can tell, I'm on the right lane. He is on the right, he's on the wrong lane. Why is he driving like that? Well, somebody must yield. If there be no accident, somebody will give way for another. You might have to park aside and let him go that time and allow yourself to be cheated at that time. That's the love. Otherwise, there'll be collision. Otherwise, there'll be accidents. Otherwise, you're going to ruin yourselves. And sometimes it's like that with husband and wife. The wife says, I am right. The man says, I am right. And then they are discussing and arguing, and nobody is willing to yield. If we love each other, you'll yield one to the other, and then you zealously serve each other. You don't serve other people with half-heartedness. You serve them with zeal. That's the love the Lord is talking about. Something practical that, you know, you'll take home. And I pray, as you do that, there'll be love in our fellowship. There'll be love in our church. And through that, we'll be building the bridge from one heart to the other in love. Don't you think it's time? I said, don't you think it's time? We'll start tonight in Jesus' name. We're looking at verse 11 again. Verse 11, it says, beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. That's the commandment the Lord has given us, and we're going to be obedient to that commandment in Jesus' name. We're looking at John chapter 13. John chapter 13, I'm reading here from verse 34. John chapter 13, verse 34. Here is what it says. It says, a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another. A new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another, as I have loved you. It says in verse 35, by this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have what? Love one for another. You know, sometimes when we meet each other, I want to demonstrate my knowledge. We can push that aside this time and just show love to one another. Other people, you know, there's something on my mind. I want to show my grievances. We can push that aside this time and then just show love to one another. There is something I've been wanting to tell you. You did something wrong about 3 years ago, and I didn't have any chance to tell you. And I want to tell you today that thing you did 3 years ago, can we push that aside at this time and just demonstrate love? Put love in the forefront and put love as the number one thing you want to show to the other person. Not any grievance and not any kind of, you know, oppression or something offensive, but just love each other. And it says, as Christ has loved us. And I pray that that love will flow from your heart to people around you. And people will know that you are children of God. People will know that you belong to Jesus Christ by the love that you show unto them. It tells us in Ephesians chapter 5. verses 1 and 2. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. It says, be ye therefore followers of God as their children. How do I follow God? Because you cannot see God in the physical. Nobody has seen God at any time. But he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God. How do you follow God? You follow love. Because it says, be ye therefore followers of God as their children. And walk, tell me, tell me out loud, and walk in love. What do you go about frowning your face? What do you go about as if the whole world has offended you? What do you go about and you never smile? What do you go about? You never give the world a smile. Every time you're moody, every time you're dejected, every time you're sorrowful, every time it's like you're fighting with somebody, every time it's like, you know, you just finished fighting, then you came out, and then you're in the process of fighting, and then when you go, you're also fighting there. Why are you like that? You're tensed up every time. Relax, relax. Because we're followers of God, and then it says, walk in love, as Christ also has loved us. As Christ also has loved us, you'll manifest that love. Yeah. You know, if you're frowning every time, nobody wants to be around you. If you're moody every time, nobody wants to be around you. You know, there are some people, permit me, there are some people that say, I don't know why. I've been in this church now for 10 years. Nobody has ever come to me and say, I want to marry you. If you see me privately, I'll tell you why. Because they are afraid of you. Every time they see you, it's like you are tensed up, you are angry with somebody, you are unhappy with somebody. And even if they wanted to say, God leads me to marry you, they are afraid, huh, this person is never happy. I have my own load I'm carrying. I don't want another load upon me. My sister, you know, if you cheer up tonight, you'll be surprised. Within 3 months, somebody will come. And you know, brother, you're always like that. So, you know, I say, brother, why are you like this every time? Oh, it says, because I'm a soldier for Christ. Everybody must see it in my eyes. They must see it in my stand. They must see it in my stature. You know, that's why when you say, I go to them and I say, the will of God, and the sister say, who? They say, soldier man. Said, never, never. I'll wait for another person. But you know, if you cheer up tonight, something will happen. Yeah. A change will come. Yeah. Because the Lord, God's family is a family of love. And if the love is there, a change is going to come. Not only in your life, it's going to come in our family. It's going to come. You know, our children, children away from their fathers, show some love and the children will ease up too. All we're looking for is love. And you know, the way you showed me love when I came today, you know, when I came and introduced me, if you, you know, test up and see if, you know, then I say, Bible study today, this is good to Bible study. But you know, you are cheerful, you are happy. That cheerfulness you gave me, go and give it to other people too. And as we give it and we blow it around and share it around, something great will happen in our lives in Jesus' name. Because it says, walk in love as Christ also has loved us and he has given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savor. It will happen. And the goodness of God will be shared in every one of our lives in Jesus' name. We're looking at 1 John chapter 4. I'm reading now from verse 16. 1 John chapter 4. And we're reading from verse 16. 1 John chapter 4 verse 16 and says, and we have known and believed the love that God has to us. Think about that. We have known and believed the love that God has for us. You have to believe that before you can be saved. You believe that God loves you. You believe that Jesus Christ died for you. You believe that if you were the only sinner in the world, Christ would still have come to die on the cross of Calvary. He says, we have known and we have believed that God has love for us. And you have to believe that to get sanctified. You know, he loves you enough, and Christ gave himself that he might sanctify and purify you. You have to believe that to be sanctified. You have to believe that for your prayer to be answered. That is, you know, that God has love towards me. He has given his promise and is going to fulfill that promise. It says, and we have known and believe the love that God has to us. God is love. Everybody say that. God is love. Say it as if you knew it. And he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God. Think about that. He that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God. Some people think, if I show love, people will think I'm soft. People will think I'm all honey and sugar. They'll suck me up. People will take advantage of me. People will not think that I have dignity, I have stamina, I have courage, I have backbone. People will not know that I'm tough if I show love. No, it says, if we show love, it will mean that we dwell in God and God in us. Which one do you want? The people will see that you are tough and that you are kind of strong, having great backbone, and you want to be like a tyrant, or for people to know that you are in God. The greatest quality you can have, the greatest qualification you can have, is for people to say that brother, he dwells in God and God dwells in him. That sister dwells in God and God dwells in her. That boy, that girl dwells in God and God dwells in him or in her. That's the greatest praise anybody can give unto you. That's why it's saying, change all this concept of wanting to be this and that, and then to oppress people and to feel that you are strong and a mighty person. It says all you need to show is that first of all receive the love of God and the mercy of God and the goodness of God, and then show that to other people. And we're going to read that verse 16 again. And we have known and believed the love that God has to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love, that's me. He that dwelleth in love, I said that's me. He that dwelleth in God, that's you. He that dwelleth in God, dwelleth in love, dwelleth in God, for and God in him. Hereby is our love made perfect. Hold on. If we have not even started, how do we perfect what we have not started? And people tell us, they told us from primary school, they said, practice makes perfect. That means that, you see, as you practice it, it takes practice. You want to help somebody, and that's not your, you have not been doing that before. It will look strange for the first time. You want to say, good morning, how are you? It will look strange. You want to say, can I help you? It will look strange before, because you have not been doing that before, but now you want to perfect it. Before you perfect something, you must start, you must practice, you must progress, you must go on. And if this is your goal, that you're going to be perfected in love, you will start tonight. At every opportunity, you will greet somebody before you go. You know, before, if you came to the Bible study to show that you are a faithful Bible study student, you come after the last amen, you pack your things, and then you're going. If anybody say, hey, brother, Bible study. Today's Bible study day. We don't greet on Bible study day. We don't love on Bible study day. We don't share on Bible study day. And then you get back home and the people are welcome, sir, welcome. Bible study day. And Bible study day has to be very, very serious. Do you know what I'm talking about? I said, you know what I'm talking about? Today there'll be a change. And what we learn today, we keep on practicing until everything is perfected in our lives. It says here, but herein is our love made perfect, that we may have what? Boldness in the day of judgment. Because As he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love. You know what that means? There's no suspicion in love. It is suspicion that makes us fearful. I'm suspecting that brother, if I do this, he's going to double cross me, knock me down. That's suspicion. I'm suspecting that sister, the way I see her, if I talk this way, she's ready to insult me. She's ready to abuse me. And because I want to keep my dignity, I don't want any insult. That's suspicion. If there is love, there's no fear in love. You give yourself away. Even if they are going to trample on you, you want to be like Jesus Christ. You want to say, I love him and I want to show my love. Whatever is going to be the reaction, I leave that in the hands of God. I'm going to build a bridge. You will build that bridge. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear has torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. That's it. We love him because he first loved us. If a man say, that's if a brother says, if a sister says, I love God and hateth his brother, I love God and hateth his brother, he is what? He's a liar. How do you know you hate somebody? You hear his voice, not just the content of what he says. He has not even said anything that, you know, we need to pick up and analyze. But you hear his voice, you are angry. You hear his voice and you are irritated. You hear his voice, you are annoyed. You hear his voice, if he is laughing, what's making him happy? If he is sorrowful, what's his problem? The whole world is on you. What's your problem? If he is dressed well, huh? Today is Christmas. If he didn't dress well, see how he came to the house of God. What's he going to do? Whatever he does, it's like, you know, you cut him down. All that must stop. We must love each other. And wherever people are, and whatever they are, you receive them as Christ has received you. Because if a man say, I love God, and hateth his brother, is a liar. I will not be a liar. For he that loveth not his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he has not seen? Then he says, brothers and sisters, this commandment have we from him. He gave you personally this commandment. Receive it. I said you receive it. That he who loveth God love his brother also. They tell us charity begins at home. He who loveth God loveth his wife also, loveth his children also, loveth her husband also, loveth the leaders also, loveth the members also. And as love fills our church here, we'll take this love out of this place, it will overflow to our neighborhood. And it is the love of God that brought us in. That same love will flow from us to our neighbors, and that love will bring them in Jesus' name. We're going to rise up and pray and tell the Lord, let the love flow. Build a bridge. Build the bridge. The bridge of love between yourself and your brother, between yourself and your sister. Let there be love. Let there be love. Practical love. Practical love. The love that will show that Christ dwells in you and you dwell in God. Let it happen. And then that love will make you a blessing to all the people around. Let's close our eyes and open our mouths and pray to the Lord. And identify somebody in particular. Somebody in particular that, you know, maybe you have not been in good terms with. And tonight you're saying, oh Lord, help me. I'll build the bridge. I'll build the bridge.